Good job, bro.
Okay, next on the agenda is Planning Department Applicant Processing Presentation, Mr. Brown.
Yes, this is where we talked about the Planning Commission getting a better idea of what our department does, particularly when a product leaves your hands. The Planning Commission has the opportunity to learn a lot about the rezoning process through your day-to-day business. What you don't get to see in a whole lot of detail is what comes after that. So we've broken this into two parts. The first tonight, the second half for January. And I have Sharon Farrell, who's our senior planner. She manages the current planning division. She's going to walk you through some of what we look at. Here's her review of products. I think the products, she picked a, I encourage her to pick a Walmart that she recently developed on Highway 41. It has a whole lot of things that not every project has. It's an overlay, it has a lot of different signs. We're not going to get chats on it, we will. Had large-scale retail requirements of his own conditions. And
time for us to go.
It's supposed to fall off this side.
No, it's good.
So, looks like Sharon's ready. I'll put a stall on and she's all set. She'll get into telling you about the process.
Going to keep this very informal. We are basically between the excitement of the walkthrough and the picking the property and the big scissors cutting the ribbon. I work for Tom Brown, of course, in the Planning and Community Development Department. I have 5 employees that are the planning and development section of plan review, permitting, processing. And we are in Forsyth County, the Planning and Community Development Department, they're the issuing authority for permits. So although we work with engineering and water and sewer, NRCS, health department, and other state and local governments, we are ultimately responsible for the permit being issued and the intake and the processing. And we have to make sure all the state licenses and state permits and everything is in order. So I have a pretty small team, and we pull it off very efficiently. Our electronic plan review, the 5-day turnaround, and our paper turnaround is a 7-day. So we're pretty excited about that. This is just your boring, typical flow chart. The site plan gets submitted on a Wednesday. And when I say site plans, what we review are clearing and grading, which is obviously just that, clearing and grading. We don't get as many of those as we used to. During the heyday, we used to get a lot of clearing and grading. It was just speculative. And you'd see the real estate sign come up and then go from there. But we do road construction, which is really just preliminary plat. We get all the information at road construction, but it's just another word for preliminary plat. And then, of course, site development, which is all the commercial. The commercial Cracker Barrel, McDonald's. We had 12 last week. It was probably one of our busiest weeks that came in for a 5-day turnaround. We do the sewer and water lines, which we have had a lot of new extensions going out there around Mullinax and those kind of places. And then, of course, the final plats. The final plats start at the engineering department, and then they get all their information and bonds and everything they need for recording. And then it gets hand carried over to us, and then we do the distribution. So, and then we do an as-built, which is after everything is constructed, and all the other departments go out and take a look at it. If everything is in order, then the surveyor gets the plan to us, and it's approved and recorded, and then they get their CO. And that is always a hectic time for us because folks are stock. They want to stock shelves. They're training employees. They've already picked a grand opening. Most recently, Dunkin' Donuts was a pretty wild one for us because they had advertised nationally that they were cutting a ribbon and people were flying in, and we were still explaining to their engineer what an as-built was. So, you know, it was kind of a fun time. And then we do minor plats, which are just 6 or less lots, basically. It's more of a mom-pa kind of homeowner process. They're not doing a full-blown final plat, they're doing six lots, usually family estate planning. But, so it comes into us, 11 sets and a fee, and of course, this is just, this is the paper process. The digital process is very different, but I knew you folks had a pretty busy agenda tonight, so.
You know, what we see is sketch plats.
Yes.
And, but then you wind up with the final plat. So, is that right?
Well, yeah, you have a process called a sketch plat.
In other words, I think the sketch plat is a concept, I think.
Right, it's neither a sketch nor a plat, it's a concept plan.
It's a concept plan, really, okay. So, how often, or how close does the concept plan end up matching the final plat generally? I mean, in other words, what we send off, what we're looking at, is that generally the way it ends up, or is it different a lot?
It's very close. It's very close. Okay. Things can change for soil and erosion conditions. We've had some projects recently that hit rock, actually, out doing road construction. Sometimes what went through the public hearing process did not get, couldn't have, because we didn't have a site plan for review. The tree preservation ordinance made some changes to the buffers. Because on the team, we have a certified planner, John Barlow, who's been with the county for over 10 years, master's in planning, and he's a certified planner. And then we also have a certified arborist. So when those folks take a look at the zoning conditions, and the survey, and all the information that comes in, and a real important part of everything we do is the soil and erosion plan, because even though we work with NRCS and engineering is responsible, it's a real integral first layer.
But a great deal of the time, what we see is pretty much the way it ends up.
If you had to pick a number, I'd probably maybe say 75%, 8 to 10. You know, they can't change too much because they've already probably invested a lot of engineering time discussion with everybody to make it through the public hearing, so they're not going to change too much. But you know, we'd have to sit down, because I don't. We pull and we look at what went through the public hearing, but we don't, you know, lay it side by side and say, well, it's got to be this, because it's got to meet the code.
So when we let go of that sketch plan, it's going to wind up something in relation.
Well,
to
it's going to be close to it.
Yeah.
When it's more than 5 acres, there's a requirement that it does match. It has to have substantial conformity to that product. Now, one of the things,
how concerned are we supposed to get about a sketch plan? You know, because if it's going to end up being a little bit or being different to a degree, then we don't need to be that concerned, because it's not going to be what we're looking at.
You need to be concerned with the general concept.
The general concept,
what you take away from today. And Sharon has on the back table there the plans that her staff reviewed before that Walmart project got signed off. And we get a dozen copies of these, and they come in a stack that you can barely carry when there's a dozen of them. There is a level of detail that takes place after these leave your hands. That is a great amount of depth these are looked at. And not only through our department, but you see all the stamps from all the other county departments, water, engineering, health, GIS, tax assessors. So there are a dozen professionals looking at these things, and they all have a long checklist of things. So the site plan you have associated with rezoning sets the general theme, the general concept. All of these details get worked into it following that point, though. And they're all code requirements. They're not things the applicant has the ability to say, well, I'm not doing it because it wasn't. We don't have to worry about that stream because they didn't get caught on the rezoning plan. It doesn't work that way. It's detailed engineered products prepared by professionals who are registered in the state of Georgia, preparing these things, people that are licensed with the state. So that's one of the things, not only to tell you a little bit about what you do, but to give you some reassurances about the level of detail that follows up your process. And when you hear something at a hearing that concerns you, it's valid to stop and ask for more information if you want to. But of also the times where you hear something out here, maybe a concern, something isn't addressed, and you can say to yourself too, you know what, I know that's not, that doesn't necessarily have to be a showstopper tonight. We can continue to let this process move forward, knowing that these hefty documents are coming and they'll be resolved. But that's a case-by-case decision you need to make, and I think hearing this puts you in a better position to make that, and that's that was part of the goal of having this today.
I don't know how to put this exactly, but I sort of kind of have the feeling that when the general public are coming up and they're speaking to rezoning or something, I think a lot of them think that that sketch plan or that concept plan is more than it is. I'm not sure, and I understand what you're saying, that the planning department has our back or is going to make sure it gets done right. And also, I guess after the public weighs in, they generally just kind of let it go. I mean, they think that's what they're going to get, but sometimes that's not exactly what they get. Should we be informing the public as saying, this is pretty much a concept and it's going to be done right, but you know, I mean, you elected people to put us in office. That way, I'm just trying to get to the point where the public doesn't come out and say, we've been misled. Not that anybody's misleading them, but because we're not.
Only that you have the codes in place and the state and federal laws.
Yeah, and all that stuff. And it opens my eyes there to see, you know, exactly what's going on, or is that going to make open a bigger can of worms if you start opening up even more?
I think we see the greatest likelihood for that in a small commercial project. We had one last month, a small car lot on Highway 9. Mm-hmm. That was under, I'm pretty sure that was under 5 acres. So
it was
1 acre. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when we talked about a lot of the public talked about the car aspect. Where are they going to unload the cars? Where are they going to get them off the truck? Where are the trucks going to park? Reality, unless, and I don't think it did, but unless it got conditioned to be a car lot, that could come through the process and not even trigger a sketch plan requirement. That could be an ice cream shop, a flower shop, an office, a dentist, anything under the sun, just about that's allowed in that zoning district, as long as they comply with the zoning requirements. So I don't think it's, I don't want to make it sound like we are misleading people, because I don't think we are.
I don't think you're
right.
But
I think with that knowledge, you can provide comments and feedback during the public hearing to say, okay, and that's just one of the possible uses that could be here if we rezone this, and alert people to the fact that, think about this as a commercial property as well, and not just the car dealership.
So you're saying that maybe we ought to make a comment during the course of our meeting?
I think you can when you, if as an individual member you hear the public or as a group or an individual getting really locked into one detail,
mm-hmm.
and you know, or you ask us and we inform
mm-hmm.
you that.
So this is not the final.
That might not be a guarantee anyways.
Mm-hmm.
Streams are a good example of that, because I think on streams, you know, we hear a lot of concern about streams.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, from the development side, there's a ton of regulation both at on the local, state, and federal level for streams. So I mean, by the end of a project, you usually have to certify on those plans.
So we're not throwing you or anybody else under the bus if we're trying to say, you know, this could change a little bit. This is the general concept. And,
very often,
you know, because I think people think that this is the concept, not the general concept.
Very likely that it can happen when you're under 5 acres.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ever have questions about that, you can ask Vanessa and I during the meeting. We can tell you about that.
From an effort standpoint, we work on the engineering side, so you know, on the design side of it, the sketch plat type of phase is usually 1/20th to 1/50th of the total amount of work that gets done on that project. And that's the reason why it's there, is because the zoning process is a more discretionary mm-hmm. thing, and it can take months and months, and you don't want to go through, it's not about not doing it right, but it's about the risk. You don't want to go through that process and take the risk of spending 6 months and a lot of money on a project that just falls through in the end, because you've got to have hard commitments for somebody to put up that kind of investment in the plans.
I think there's certain products too. I mean, I spoke with a developer who does senior housing projects, and it's a multi-phase project. And when you're discussing something like that, there's some aspect of that phasing that it might be a little unclear, that their product might shift a little bit in the final phase depending on what the market is demanding. So there is some flexibility, but I think there's an understanding too that, you know, if they do have to come back and it significantly is different, so a sketch plan would be triggered, they understand that there's that certain amount of risk, but they feel pretty confident that their first phase or first and second phase is going to be as it is on the concept plan. But I think the timing of it, I mean, we never know, of course, when the rezoning process is done. We get a lot of calls from the public, well, when are they coming in for their permit? You know, we certainly have no idea. It could be immediate, or certainly it could be years. Things happen. And I think that, you know, we are seeing certain sketch plans just because some things were rezoned several years ago, and now things are different. So there, I think that possibility will remain to some extent.
Now, Sharon, we can access all of that information online.
You can.
Clearing and grading, and we
yes,
can look
and
at that.
That's the beauty of our e-status program. All of this is online. And it's all, you know, color coordinated with the clearing and grading, and everything is very well organized in the e-status plan online information. Now, it is not scanned when it's submitted. It's not scanned and placed online until it's approved. But folks can still come in and take a look at the plans. And of course, with this particular project, there was a lot of interest. I mean, I could use this as an example, or the Dunkin' Donuts, which was a very small building. There was no public interaction other than, oh, awesome, when are they going to open? You know, and that type of thing. It was a good project. It was an overlay, so it went through. That was an enjoyable project to work with. And again, with this one, you not only have the state, federal, and local regulations. We have two PEs in engineering, a PE in water and sewer. We work with the two folks from the NRCS for also the soil and erosion and the NEPIDs. And then we also have to review a photometric plan. So it is just such a moving project all the time, because we may have to move some lights around to meet a zoning condition, or to make sure we don't have the, you know, candle power spilling over the property line, and then that's going to maybe shift something, or a pipe has to be moved, Bill Powell needs a pipe moved, and that's going to mess up our arborist tree plant. So, you know, it's, I can't even imagine how difficult it is from the engineering side. I mean, because I'm just involved with one piece of the pie for site development, so I'm sure engineers
too. And this is also not only for commercial, but also for the residential.
For the residential. And the residential is, we're very, very busy, but we also have unique zoning conditions with those, as well as the architectural residential reviews. But we also are dealing with, I'm sure you guys have heard, you know, with the builders picking up the last phase or changes. And we have now come back with larger lots, and well, the water meter's already in, so we're pulling meter, you know, so it's been a pretty exciting year for us as far as how busy we are and how complex the projects have been. And but at the same time, a lot of neighbors that were kind of not upset but not happy that projects were just dead, so some buffers maybe that they were waiting to be planted, you know, now that activity is kicked up again. So we're getting a lot of folks coming in and saying, hey, who bought it, who's building, how, you know, are they going to build? So it's been a pretty exciting year for us. And then we've also kicked off the digital plan review with e-status, which is another whole evening of, it's all digital until the very end. So that's been a tough project and process for staff to run. But the engineers like it. I'm told it saves about $700 per submittal. Sometimes we can do three or four submittals with one tough project.
All the conditions that you put out in rezoning show up on these plans, both in listed in paragraph format, mm-hmm. and also incorporated into the plan itself, if surveys.
Yeah, we usually have to call them up.
That's why it's so important that can, that our conditions are stated right.
What?
In a form that it can be.
Yes, because after, not only do we have to decipher them to get them on the site plan properly, but as they finish this work and they're getting ready to get the store up and running, we'll send the code enforcement department out to do a site visit to check that the zoning conditions are actually implemented. So if it's set a buffer, if you need an extra buffer, we'll make sure, assurance staff will make sure the buffer shows up on the plans.
Can I clear something?
Planner will make sure that the proper plantings are shown right down to the plant, and the code enforcement staff will go in the field to verify that they're actually there before that place opens up for business. So having fairly precise conditions is really essential to that process, making it smooth.
Okay. Conditions. Are those our conditions or the Board of Commissioners' conditions that are showing up on there?
Board of Commissioners.
That's what I thought. Okay. So it's not ours. So my kind of feeling is our conditions are reasonably. I kind of feel a little bit differently about it than you do, with all due respect, that whatever conditions that we put on there can be changed, and they won't be on that. And so our conditions are not.
Oftentimes that is the case, but yeah, oftentimes it isn't.
Yeah, sometimes. So it's not. I understand what you're saying, that we do need to be as accurate as we can, but it's not like ours is the final product, because it gets looked at, you know, and depending on what the Board of Commissioners, with all due respect to them, they're going to do what they want to do, and that's what they're elected to do. So that was, I just wanted to make sure that everybody understood that those aren't our conditions. That's
right. And I think it goes back to us justifying our existence by providing value to the board and giving them a good product. We want to give them some conditions that, in my mind, if they didn't want to touch them, they said just, we like what you did, go with it. We're not changing a word, that they'd be ready to do that. And that should, in my opinion, should be our goal, month in and month out. But we'd also be foolish to think that they're never going to change, because they do, and they change often.
Right. Now, there's some things that are just outside of our jurisdiction as well, right? Like, if you, there's a
part of the point
Georgia Department of Transportation right-of-way. Well, I'm saying outside of the county's jurisdiction altogether, yeah. Things like the right-of-way. If we're looking at a zoning and it's on the state right-of-way, yeah. The state is going to tell what has to be done in the state.
I guess what I'm trying to say is, you know, our conditions aren't the be-all and all. We're not the big wheels on the, we're just part of the cog.
That's right. We're
on the conditions and so.
Our recommendations.
And that list up there, like it says, all the signature, that's all the different departments.
That is all, that's what we call the route sheet, and basically engineering and the city. We also work very closely with the city of Cumming. They attend our plan review. They can get onto our digital plan review, so we have a really good working relationship with them. And then, of course, the fire marshal sees it, the health department, the tax assessor's office, addressing, and then in planning, it's the intake coordinator to make sure that the current property owner is correct, because sometimes there's some closings going on, and they're real sticklers about who the current property owner is on the day they approve it. And then, of course, Greg Wallace, the arborist, who does tree preservation, but he also does landscaping plan, and does a couple site visits, and he does the site visits for you folks for the rezonings too. So he follows the project from the rezoning to the very end. And then, of course, the project manager, which in that case was Joan Barlow, is busy planning.
We're going to come back. If we have more questions, obviously, we'll try to answer them. But another brief component of this presentation in January, talking about once they're done preparing the site and the building is actually coming up, construction, and just a quick overview of that side of the office: sign permits, alcohol permits, business licensing, building permits, and building inspections, which is a big role we do. And then probably the thing that brings us to the site most often. Thanks.
Thank you. That was good.
No, you're a big help for us too.
And we are just
reviewing and about to approve the venue apartments for the apartments down on the.
Just put that in the back. Here in the back, just leave it.
Oh, sure, sure. Pretty light. Staff's getting a little nervous today when I found out Walmart plans.
I'm like, oh no.
Next is you also, Mr. Brown, discussion regarding motions when variances are requested.
Yes, this one needs to be pretty quick. When, we are actually, I think, at a phase of seeing fewer variances, but we went through a long phase of seeing the norm was one or two variances on every application. It looks like that's changing. But when Vanessa and I are we're talking during the public hearing, trying to sort everything out. When we have an application that includes a variance, in the future, what I'd like to do, if the Planning Commission finds it acceptable, is that the motion specifically includes either a statement of, yes, the variances are included, or no, they're not. In the past, we've kind of defaulted, we've unofficially seemed to have this policy that if they weren't mentioned, that means they weren't included. But honestly, there's been days where Vanessa and I, after the fact, are listening to the tape, and I think that's hard to sort out at times. And if I'm having a hard time sorting it out after the fact, when I have the luxury of pausing and rewinding, it's a hard task to ask you to do live at the meeting with cameras rolling and 100 people in the audience. So we're going to try to, and if you find it annoying or it's not the way you want to do it, we're open to other suggestions. But we were going to. Whenever you have an application with a variance, if your motion doesn't clearly say to approve or deny the variances, and we catch it, we're going to ask at the meeting that you clarify that and modify the motion to state that. So everyone, all five members right there, know exactly what we're voting on. So we've had a couple where we'd say, well, the application as requested, and then not mention the variances, and Vanessa and I would have a hard time figuring out. The application technically included a variance, but they didn't mention it, and the one before they did mention it. So we're going to try to do that.
And what our practice has been, however your motion is stated, is what is recorded in the minutes. I will say, of course, sometimes conditions include the variance request, and that's fairly common, so I know at times that you're not specifically calling out variance because it's a condition, however you wish to handle it. But again, it's going to be based on your motion, of course, what is shown on the screen. What you read off will be what will be included in the minutes.
So are we seeing as many variances?
Sometimes, coming down the pike.
Since there's been attention brought to it.
Consistent.
Okay.
However you wish to do it, just be clear that whatever your motion is, it's not a condition that you say or state what you intend.
I guess I'll ask one more question kind of along those lines is, I know I brought it up to tweak the comprehensive plan. When, is that like in January, February, do you recall?
That sounds accurate.
I believe it is January. I can send an email out tomorrow to see exactly what agenda it was placed on.
Do you think there might be a chance of us hearing from the commissioners that they, I mean, rather than getting a couple hours notice, as I have been known to get, as to how they don't want us changing things, do you think there's much chance of them sending a letter at the last minute saying they don't want us to tweak the UDC, even though the state law says that we're supposed to?
You mean the comprehensive plan?
Comprehensive plan, yeah.
I don't see.
Well, I think our meeting in January is just to discuss options of what has to be done in order if there ever is a change.
Well,
I don't think we were making any contact
with the commission probably more than that. Do you think that we're going to be hearing from them saying stay away from that?
I have no idea.
We can make a motion.
What I'm telling you is that in January, I believe it is January, what we're going to talk about is exactly what's involved and if we do want to do that. And then I think if we want to individually speak to our commissioner and see how they feel about it and tell them what we may or may not do, that we're looking into this, and get their feedback that way.
Because you got a letter, I didn't get one.
We're gonna talk about this later.
Yeah, but I mean, it's on the same line of surprising me.
But we're on variances and the motions request.
I'm tying the two in together by saying if this is gonna be a trend, then maybe we ought to just forget about it.
Well, right now we're discussing motions with variances. Okay. We're not discussing that.
Well, so in January or February, whatever, I'm hoping that we'll be discussing a long-term plan.
So you want us to state whether it's with a motion, I mean with the variance or without the variance, and if we don't, then one of you will speak up.
That's right. Okay. Let's try that for a few months, and if you think that's not working, let's reassess. Back up and come up with plan B. But I think that would be good
because sometimes I get ahead of myself, and I think that I've said without the variance or with the variance. There was one instance I know where I had a percentage. I okayed a zoning with the variance, and then in my conditions I stated that there was a percentage of lots that the variance could be used upon, which I knew when I did it would be confusing, but I knew it also would be fixed.
Okay, that's all I have.
Okay.
Thank you.
Next is discussion regarding setback encroachments, variances, and conditions. That also is Mr. Brown.
All right. Grab one of those and pass it around. And earlier this year, it came through the Planning Commission and we saw it. It was an ordinance change regarding encroachments. And it came in two different pieces. The first one, it focused exclusively on setbacks. And the second one, it included building separation as well. And it's the 18-inch exemption, 18-inch rule. My staff, it's 18-something. That's what signifies people know what we're talking about. I wanted to get a chance to talk with the Planning Commission because I know at a staff level, when this first got adopted in the ordinance, we had some staff people that were going back and forth and found it confusing. And when you go to apply that 18-inch exemption to very particular projects, how does it apply? And we had made up for a staff meeting I had a couple months ago, we had made up this kind of cheat sheet, very close to this, it was slightly different. I wanted to run through this quick with the Planning Commission and make sure that the training we provided my staff should have also probably way back then provided the Planning Commission, honestly, but it didn't seem like it was coming up that much at the Planning Commission level. But the more I think about it, the more I thought, it is worth visiting. So I'm going to run through this and kind of come close to reading it to you, and I apologize for that, but I think it's the easiest way to do it. The top half of the page is just really a cut and paste of our UDC requirement. 18 inches of encroachment for things that are generally architectural features, and it's most commonly the roof overhang. So you get a foot and a half on each side of the structure. Now in the bottom half is more the focus of when does this apply and when does it not apply. The first line is just for a standard setback or building separation in the UDC, that's the most obvious one, it applies. In Res 3, we have a requirement for 5 feet between 5 feet off the property line, 20 feet between structures, the 18-inch exemption applies to that.
Meaning that the rooftops would be
17 feet. Correct. The next one, what about when we sign off on a variance to that requirement I just discussed and we reduce that? The answer is the 18-inch encroachment still applies there. So we reduce it down to 15 feet, those rooftops could now be 12 feet apart. Third example, this one doesn't come up as often at the Planning Commission, but a setback or a building separation.
Wait a minute, excuse me. Mm-hmm. You said 15 feet, they could be 12 feet. It wouldn't be 13 and a half apart? I mean, on each side?
Each home gets 18 inches if we're talking about residential.
Oh, okay, okay.
So a foot and a half on each side, which gets you to three.
Yeah, thanks for clearing that up.
The third case doesn't come up as often as the planning commission, but it might as the rezoning process is starting to pick back up. MPD, master plan districts, or PUDs, planned unit developments. Those are projects where they propose their own development standards, as they propose their own setbacks. And the 18-inch encroachment would apply there as well. Fourth one, a setback or building separation established by a zoning condition, but the zoning condition does not reference how to measure the setback or the building separation. It just says there'll be a setback of 10 feet. There'll be a building separation of 20 feet. The answer there is similar to everything you've heard so far. Yes, the 18-inch exemption would apply. Encroachment, 18-inch encroachment. The fifth one is where it gets a little unique, and this is, I think, one that will come up the most potentially at the Planning Commission, is if we have a setback or a building separation established by a zoning condition, but that condition includes wording that references how to measure the setback or the building separation. And the example we've seen a lot in the past is a condition that will say 20 foot separation between structures measured foundation to foundation, or measured eave to eave, measured from the exterior building material to exterior building material. So when a condition tells my inspectors who are going out on site to measure these things, when the condition has wording that tells them exactly how to measure it, then I'm not applying that 18-inch exemption. If it says measure foundation to foundation, that's what we're measuring from, and the 18 inches, the 18-inch encroachment wouldn't apply. The final one I had was easements, and the 18-inch encroachment never applies to an easement. But we're not going to permit an overhang in an easement. Something's not going to happen. That's quick. It's a lot to throw at you. If you have questions now, we have to try to answer them, or if you think of something later, want to email or call me or discuss it at a future meeting, let me know. But it's something I know it took some coordination at our staff late summer to all get on the same page. So just catching up with it and bringing it to the Planning Commission as well.
I would guess that special wording should be used with extreme discretion, just because it does invite inconsistency in what an inspector sees. And
it does, yeah.
Potential for missing it and then coming back and finding that, oh, well, there was this word and it wasn't even necessarily intended. So.
It's something we may want, years ago on the Planning Commission, I don't know if we had the best example, but the general theme, we had a document that had 15 of the most common zoning conditions.
Yeah.
And the wording, we sent around all the different departments, and everyone in my staff looked at it, and we all said, yeah, that wording we like, we know what it means, we know how to apply it, and if we always use it, it's quicker for us to move through the process too. And if you want to go back to something like that, something we can definitely help you create is that kind
it's
of running list.
It's when I said PC1, PC2,
right, yeah.
Conditions.
That there were some that may apply exclusively to residential and some exclusively to commercial, and it was that kind of thing where it was, if it was a, you know, we want to make the buffer bigger, the number was just a fill in the blank, but all the wording leading up to and following it was standard, and the Planning Commission would always say, I know what I'm getting if I ask for that.
I think that might be a really good thing for us to have, because I struggle sometimes with the wording because of my intent with conditions. I want to make sure that what I intend to have happen, recommend, but sometimes my wording may not be my intent.
It's very easy, I tell you, at the meeting to, it's very easy for Vanessa and I to spend a month drafting a code and get adopted and realize it doesn't say what we've always said. So on the fly at a meeting to try to do it is a challenge.
Yeah.
You know, I know we had a couple last month that I thought, yeah, I bet that's what they wrote, and it's accurate.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, there was one that said, all lots shall be 12,000 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know that probably the intent was a minimum of 12,000
mm-hmm.
square feet, but it said all lots should be 12,000
yeah.
square feet.
There
and that's the kind of thing, this could help if we had a standard fill in the blank.
all you're sticking is the 12,000 and all the other work is there, you don't have to do it on the fly. So here's some general interest in that. That's something maybe not for December or maybe not even January, but by February I could put on this meeting and try to come up with some common ones.
I would like that. I think it would be very, very helpful.
Something else that would make things a lot less complicated would be to totally do away with encroachments. Then everybody would be pretty clear as to what's going on.
Well, we have that. You know, I think, I'll tell you one, yes, ideally, but I'm not sure it's possible because we have so many zoning conditions already that tell us the opposite. We have so many zoning conditions that say measure from foundation to foundation or footing to footing or...
Well, what if we just had one encroachment? I'm trying to make it simpler so that things could be more efficient. You know, I mean, on the other hand, you could say, why are these the only encroachments we have? Why don't we have 10 more?
Says other features as determined by
the director. That's what I read that part. That makes it even more complicated. Because tell me what one of those other features would be. I don't either.
Small cantilever.
But that's what I mean. It could be anything.
Yeah.
So maybe we might want to help the planning department out by making
it
more standard.
Easier on them because they have so many already.
Yeah, I'm not sure it would.
Well, I guess sure it would get confusion with people.
Let me describe one other thing to you. Well, one other thing that makes the not getting into roof overhangs when a standard overhang easier is that when the inspector is standing on site and you've got a basement and a two-story house, that roof overhang is 35, 40 feet in the air. And the homes have 10 feet of elevation difference between them and the other home. Trying to measure that down to the inch, he can't do anyways. It's a little easier to measure. And what he can do usually is eyeball and say, I know this builder. I've inspected 50 of their homes in the last week. Mm-hmm. I know they use an 18-inch overhang. So I don't have to worry about that. And I can focus on this wall here that I can actually put my hand on and try to determine if that is 10 feet from the property line or not. So it actually can make life a little easier for the inspector, only because it puts within reach what he's trying to measure.
Yeah. So that's what I mean, it would be real simple if you just said wall to wall. Period. Everybody would know what you're talking about.
Okay, well.
Wall to wall, you do have encroachment.
Wall to wall would mean we didn't care about encroachments at all and there'd be no cap on them. And I don't think that they'd come up often, but sooner or later you're going to have the example where someone does something extreme.
I have a big curved glass that sticks out for a window.
That's what it is.
Yeah, someone has a, what's the building down? Is it the Southern Power building downtown? The kind of area store goes up.
Oh, yeah, that is that building.
You know, all of a sudden you're going to see that's going to be the new home in Forsyth County. Maybe not, but maybe a rare occasion you see that. So I will in January or February come back. You kind of just leave it up in the air. Let me see how many more things land on January's agenda. We already have a couple. But one of those 2 months, I'll come back to you with an initial start at this common list of conditions, and then in the future, we have one that we're using a lot. It's not on there. It's as simple as saying, hey, let's get it on there. We'll make it available to you, give you an updated copy of each month, let you know what changed, if anything. And if it makes your life easier, that's great. It'll definitely make our life easier because over time, seeing that same wording again and again, it's just quicker.
And remember, you had the residential on one side and the commercial on the other paper, right?
Yes.
If there's some architectural standards guidance too, because I know that could be a huge amount of labor on staff to try, there's certain things that you could call out so many percent.
You mean like monotonous appearance? Isn't that part of one of the ones that's used all the time?
What?
To avoid monotonous appearance.
Well, I was thinking, like, if you say 73% brick and
20%,
somebody's got to go out. How does an inspector measure that?
Yeah.
We've gotten into that in the last 5 years. It used to be just you need to have brick.
Yeah.
And as soon as you get to a percentage, Ethan and I end up spending a lot of time on the phone talking about
ninjas got a number of bricks.
542.
That's all I had there. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Tom.
Yeah. Review and discussion of the Buford Highway Overlay District. Ms. Goldman.
Oh, it's been a while since we've had a UDC change, so this will be the first of two required public hearings. This is an item that the board has wanted staff to move forward with. It has been on hold for a number of months due to staffing issues. So the draft is being brought before you, and it's based on several work session discussions. It was originally prompted by Commissioner Ball. The overlay is entirely within his district. It encompasses a 500-foot swath, 250 feet on either side of the highway. The area is in the darker color on your map. That would be the extent. It focuses on landscape and parking requirements for non-residential uses. It also has specific signage requirements and outdoor lighting regulations. In terms of uses, there are specific standards related to vehicle-related establishments, and that includes everything from vehicle service, parts, repair, rental, and sales establishments. So there are specific standards for those types of businesses.
There are what?
There are specific standards for vehicle-related. Spans everything from vehicle sales and rental to repair, as well as any type of service.
That's the county has specific standards.
This overlay would have over and above our general UDC requirements.
It would
focus upon those types of businesses for specific standards, just within the overlay.
You mentioned that this is going to apply to non-residential, and when I read through this, I might just be missing it, but I could not find in the delineation of district that it excluded any residential district. That was my biggest concern, is there is a lot of residences that back up to the highway.
The site design standards, if you look, it's 21-11.5. It's on page 1. It talks about the parking for commercial establishments, so those parking regulations will be related to residential use. And then you see a statement about new commercial development. And in regards to the landscaping, this would require a 20-foot strip. Now, as we know, with any corridor, we're looking at areas that have already been developed that essentially are grandfathered in. So as they go into a significant expansion or they're being redeveloped, these overlay standards would not apply. The same is true of all of our other overlays on the corridors. So really the focus, and we had, before we went to a work session, you know, we had discussions with Commissioner Bob, and, you know, looking at staff has guided as to what he was interested in, was his, what he had heard from various constituents. And then there were, you know, numerous discussions with the board on this overlay. We also contacted all the contractors along the corridor and did receive feedback. We ended up changing.
Did you have to contact the property owners when we did other overlays?
I was not involved with all of the other overlays.
Contact the property owners when we did other overlays?
Well,
all the property. I didn't think we did.
Overlays,
it's just in this one district where we had to.
With Peachtree Parkway, we did contact many of the property owners.
But you weren't directed to?
Whether we were directed or not, I can't answer.
Yeah, this is the only overlay.
I think with the Castleberry overlay, people were contacted too who live in the area.
be in contact.
I recall that in both of those overlays that I've worked with, that we contacted.
There's one other thing that's, that is kind of a, it's in my district. Not my district, but the fifth district. I understand there's not a whole lot of architectural guidelines in this particular, or is that right?
There are not, the focus is on landscaping and, there are display and storage standards, not architectural requirements.
Okay, and architectural standards, would be a little more burdensome for the store operators and stuff.
Well, we have our basic code requirements for commercial development.
I understand.
And our architectural requirements.
And when you say we, you mean the county?
The county and UDC.
Okay, now this overlay is different than all the other overlays in the county, because it butts up to the city of Cumming.
All of the overlays are different. I mean, each one is unique in its own atmosphere.
How many of those butt up to the city of Cumming? You didn't hear what I said. I said, this is different in the fact that it doesn't butt up to the city of Cumming, or this one does, the rest of them didn't. That means that if we do architectural guidelines or anything, there's gonna be a little bit more onerous to the shops than, since they're in relation to the city, and this has already been happening along Buford Highway. Marketplace Boulevard, the city used to end on the other side of 400. They've annexed out, you know, to Sanders Road so far. Now, if you go look at the proposed annexations for the city of Cumming, I'm sure you're familiar with them, aren't you? All you gotta do is look at Highway 20, and they're proposed to go on out Highway 20 to keep on going out that way. So that means that if we put a lot of restrictions on Lusol, you know, then this guy's gonna say, city of Cumming, why don't y'all just annex this? It's just another. And besides, it's in the area where you want to annex anyway, because you've got it written down there, it's proof. And we can get cheaper water, and we won't have to have the onerous architectural guidelines. So that's the difference in this, and say Peachtree Parkway and those others, is that we can go out there with all the best intentions of the world to try to do what we think is good and nice and pretty. But right behind will be coming the city of Cumming, and they're going to be invited out there because their conditions and stuff are not as hard as ours, and then it'll be a retrograde. And the more we try to make it look more beautiful and architecturally correct, the quicker those people are going to come into the city. Just wonder how long it's going to be before Lusol is annexed into the city. I mean,
I believe Commissioner Boff requested this overlay.
That's
right?
True.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the architectural conditions and stuff.
We don't have architectural material requirements.
People are concerned because they don't have architectural, and I'm trying to tell you, there's a reason for not having a lot of architectural conditions, because the more you put on, the quicker those people are going to want to be annexed into the city so they can get out from under that. That's what I'm trying to say. You understand what I'm saying?
Well, yeah, but we don't have any control over that. We're not supposed to be looking at
but
that.
But I can't
That's
explain
not part of our...
what's going on, and we do need to know what's going on. I mean, were you aware that the city plans to annex out 20?
Yes, Commissioner Moses, I am aware of that.
Okay, well, that's all I'm saying is we all need to be aware of that.
There are architectural designs in this. They're just not
architectural materials.
Right.
Which means there isn't a certain percentage of brick or stone. That is not part of this overlay. We have very generalized standards about what I would say that certain design embellishments shall not be a dominant architectural feature, which means something that looks, for instance, like a castle or other thematic type of buildings.
We've got them out there.
Should not be, you know, the dominant feature of a building.
Since everybody seems to know or be aware of that, do we want to try to get more architectural guidelines since it's not being proposed?
What's your suggestion?
My suggestion is to ask you all for some guidance since it's in my district. Would y'all prefer to see heavier architectural guidelines?
No, I thought you were proposing.
No, I'm asking you. The proposal doesn't have them in there.
Right.
I'm asking you if y'all don't like that. If the Planning Commission, this is a planning issue. If the Planning Commission doesn't like the fact that we don't have more stringent architectural guidelines, would y'all like to see more stringent architectural guidelines? It's a question.
My preference for architectural guidelines is at intersections and not on a linear path, because you don't necessarily want a linear, you know, 15 miles of the same exact standard. So you got, if you have a key intersection and there's a civic association that wants to be formed or a group that wants to try and, you know, do something in that area that's going to be consistent with the architecture and the landowners support it, I think that's great.
But should it be included?
This is a linear type of overlay.
So you don't think that it ought to be in architectural guidelines? I appreciate you being forthright with that. How about you? Have you got an opinion on that?
I think for the area that this is in, that what has been proposed here with the overlay district is more than adequate.
I'm looking for help.
You know, I think what they've done is going to work out just fine.
I don't see any problems with it.
Okay, so when somebody comes in here and says, we want more stringent architectural guidelines, 5-0 on the Planning Commission says it's fine like it is.
Like it is here?
Just what y'all said is on tape. Everybody said it's fine like it's presented. Is that what y'all said? That's what I heard.
That's an issue.
Because there is
it's fine
leniency.
Like it's
there is leniency in this plan. This is the minimum.
Well,
you
know,
can increase it based on a per site
option. I'm in agreement with you all.
So you can't say we said we agree with this, which means we can't ever have a different opinion.
No, I
that's
didn't
not
say
fair
that.
Because
at this moment in time,
just like Alan said, at each intersection there may be a group of citizens that are specifically asking for something, or there may be one large building that we'd like to, you know, focus in on, make sure that it looks a certain way. This is a minimum. This is the code requirement. This is not a blanket. This is what's going to be the absolute Bible of what we do.
And that's great. And we're all in sync on that. And I am too. And the point I'm trying to get at is when somebody or an organization comes and says, why didn't you put more stringent architectural guidelines on there? I just gave y'all a good reason for not doing it. It's because it'll be annexed and then they'll go down. But I'm also hearing you all say what you said, which is, you know, the minimum, that everybody's pretty well happy with the minimum. So in other words, what's proposed at this point in time is satisfactory to all 5 of the planning commissioners.
I think you worded that differently than what I said. I said that architectural standards can be beneficial.
Yeah, you were the one different. Everybody else said the other is what I heard. What I'm trying to get to is that Jim Boff has been working for a long time to get this brought up to the commission, and I think it would be and he's finally succeeded in getting it this far, and I think it'd be a shame for groups or individuals to begin criticizing this overlay because it doesn't have more stringent architectural guidelines.
We can't control that. We're saying it's good.
Did that answer your question? I've already seen people say, why don't they have architectural guidelines. I thought that's what an overlay was for.
Well, the county has architectural guidelines with commercial development, and this is on top of those architectural guidelines. Some of those already exist that are in some ways more stringent than what is in here for the county.
Yeah, okay.
So
I'm just trying,
between
the
two of them,
cut down on the criticism.
Between the two of them, there are quite a bit of architectural design guidelines in them that would have to abide by.
So, like you said, you're reasonably happy with that. I'm reasonably happy with it too, even though it doesn't have a whole lot of architectural guidelines, like Peachtree and Industrial has more.
Right.
The problem with having more is that might work to the disadvantage. And that has already been thought through, and there's already been criticism that there's not enough. And I just want to make sure that if y'all want more, you know, we need to discuss it and think about it and let the commissioner know.
I think we're prepared to defend it.
The way it is there. And that's all I'm trying to say.
Do you have anything else, Vanessa, about it?
No. I'll make a general presentation. The map will be shown on the screen, and of course, I'll be available. Yeah.
So I'm happy. I'm happy with it. I'm just trying to get a consensus that everybody's on the same page, that they know what they're in favor of.
What is there a time frame on 21-115C6? Has all dead and damaged plant material within landscape areas must be replaced within
certain time? That is if it, at any point in time.
Now, what about a property that's existing today? If their plant material dies, they didn't come in under this, does that then apply to it?
I might have to check the grid on that.
And likewise, this,
I wouldn't want it to apply, and I think, right. I sure wouldn't hurt to put some water in there to clarify that.
Okay. And the other part about that was that the way that it reads, if I understand, I'm not an expert on this for sure, but 21-11.5, up to 21-11.5, there's no specific reference that would exclude residential. So I was just thinking it might be easy if in delineation of district, if you included either the zoning districts in combination with that, or just excluded
For the landscaping portion, yes, I see that it does commercial establishments and commercial development in A and B. But for C, I'll make note of that. What I can do is have some wording available next week, that I could provide, that would provide further clarification.
Okay. That'd be perfect, because I mean, outside of that, you're right. There is nothing else that could be construed as applying to an individual owner. But I don't want somebody getting a fight with their neighbor in their backyard and then have to go replace trees.
Any other comments about this? Vanessa, you are up next. Review and discussion of Chapter 8 UDC changes.
What will happen is this will be one public hearing, so I will move forward when the Pickford Highway Overlay District is called. Everyone, I've just clarified this, and I will come up and present the UDC changes as a bundle, so to speak. Now, I'll be very clear about what chapter and what the topic is, but both of these are the first hearings. So I will go into the Buford Highway Overlay District. I'll make a very brief presentation, and then I'll go into these Chapter 8 changes. The Chapter 8 changes focus just on two topics. The first are our requirements for our site development plan submittal for our applications. If the proposal is greater than 20 acres, then a Georgia licensed landscape surveyor, engineer, landscape architect, or architect would need to stamp the concept plan when it comes in for rezoning, additional use, home occupation. Now, if it's less, of course, than 20 acres, that would not be the requirement.
And this came from
conflict from the.
This is also a board directed change, and this was one that we tried to bundle these changes together just to reduce the number of UDC versions. It's awesome.
It was months and months and months ago when we first started working on this.
I'd like to compliment the board on their wisdom on changing that.
The other change in the chapter has to do with applicant initiated postponements, and this is across the board. It goes beyond rezoning applications. But when it is a postponement is initiated by the applicant would pay a legal ad re-advertisement cost and would be responsible for amending their signs to indicate the new public hearing date. And it clarifies that that would be not the discretionary. This again will be a very brief presentation.
So,
the tentative schedule, just so you're aware, because would be if the planning commission chooses to make a recommendation next Tuesday, it would go before the board in January. It would not be a back to back.
Anybody have any other comments about this UDC change?
I think that means good. It makes it a lot clearer.
I know they had talked about doing 40 acres, but then they decided on 20.
I think that was a wise decision to do 20. Okay.
Anybody else have anything? Thank you. Meeting minute review, Ms. Goldman.
So I wanted to discuss three edits made to the October 22nd public hearing minutes. These will be the minutes that you will consider for adoption on Tuesday. On page 4, right above announcements, in regards to the adoption of the minutes. For the October 15th work session minutes, there was a clarification that the three members in favor were Bowman, Iglesias, and Moses, since Neil abstained. I had Neil twice, and it was I needed to switch out. Moses was in favor, Neil was abstaining, since Ellen, you were not present at that particular. On page 9, there was clarification on the member who is absent. So I'll just read out what the final motion was. Motion carried with three members in favor, Bowman, Iglesias, and Neil, and one opposed, Nolan, with one member absent, Moses. Now, sometimes when there's three categories of individuals, the names were. And then on page 10, under the list of conditions, under number 6, it reads the development rather than the developer shall be single family residential on 8.97 acres. So those were the conditions. I will send out the draft minutes for this work session.
I'd like to once again compliment you on what a thorough job you're doing with the minutes. It sure is nice to get thorough minutes. Before you came on board, our minutes kind of, I felt like, touched the highlights. And so it's very understandable that some things, when you're being more thorough and the minutes are a little bit longer, it's understandable that things are going to be a little different. But I, for one, really appreciate the amount of detail you put in the minutes.
Thank you. And I appreciate all of you when you call and yours to my attention.
Review and discussion of application scheduled for public hearing on November 26, 2013. First off is ZA3638.
You have a revised staff report in your folder. This is based on the submission of the public participation report, which would be recommended by staff report. This is District 3. Do you have anything, Mr. Nolan?
No.
This has been around for a while because it's been postponed, so. He just didn't have the proper zoning on that piece of property to do what he was doing out there. Isn't that correct?
Correct. Correct.
Yeah. Code enforcement. He's been doing it for a long time, code enforcement.
Well, I mean, I'm going to ask a question. It has nothing to do with thinking there's any intent here, but just in what we discussed earlier, if this gets zoned CBD, would it have to come, since it's going to be used for open storage or open air type thing, and there's no structure proposed, if someone was going to build a commercial structure on it, once it's zoned CBD, they wouldn't need to go back to zoning. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Unless it was conditioned.
But site development then would change, since there's no permanent structure, they're not coming in for parking or any structural change.
Right.
If site development permit is triggered because that changes, then you would then assess what they would have to do to course improve.
Sure, I mean, it would still have to be in accordance with the UDC,
yes.
But just another example
of
like
that
whole.
An elected or appointed board would not see it.
Okay, that's what I was just wanting to mention with that earlier, is that we're talking about there could be some changes.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in some situations there can be total deviations unless it was conditioned strictly.
Agreed.
Okay.
The only time you would see it is if for any reason, this is paired with a conditional use permit, when there are changes to the nature of the use, and if it potentially re-triggered a new cup, then it would have to go back. That would be the only time, if a commercial change necessitated a new copy.
Sure. Okay. I mean, part of it, as I just want to mention too, is that if there was a structure, we might be looking at specific conditions, and it allows for a zoning to go without condition, and unless it was conditioned, that it would have to go back.
But the chances are, if there is a change later on, then
I'm taking it off this piece of property. We're just talking theoretically.
Yeah.
Well, when a board would see it, of course, is a sketch plat, which means, if whatever is approved at this stage, if there's a substantial difference in that property, it's over 5 acres, a sketch plat would be triggered and the board of commissioners would approve it.
Okay.
And conditions can be.
And chances are, if this is changed, the cup will probably change with it. Is that, am I wrong on that? There's a good chance that.
A good chance.
Yeah. So that way it becomes.
But this, of course, is just over an acre. So, that's right. A sketch plat.
That's what I was saying.
Any other comments on this? Craig, have you heard from anybody about this at all?
Yes.
Has anybody heard from anyone? I haven't. No one's contacted me about it.
I think the fact that they've been doing it for as long as they have, nobody really cares.
Well, and according to his public participation, there was one person at his meeting,
yeah,
and they just wanted to know if it was going to change, if it would stay the same. So. Next is ZA-3642, Home South Communities, LLC, and that's going to be postponed because of the public participation
report was not submitted, and so this will be an announcement made as we will amend the agenda.
Will there be any, with it being postponed and stuff, will there be much chance of the staff becoming supportive rather than non-supportive?
Or you think
that'll probably
any changes
so,
to the staff
so, that, so that'll probably stay the same.
Next is Ryland Group, ZA-3643, and they have withdrawn without prejudice.
No, they cannot withdraw without prejudice unless
they cannot
before you at the public hearing.
So they have to ask.
They have to ask.
Okay.
Once it's been legally advertised.
So it hasn't technically been withdrawn then?
It has not been withdrawn.
Hmm.
Because at this time we would have to withdraw with prejudice. Staff does not have the power to grant it to be without prejudice because it's
so it's still
advertised
on the agenda.
It's still on the agenda.
But they'll be asking
they
to withdraw.
That is my understanding.
They will,
yes.
Okay.
Okay. Next is ZA 3651, Legacy Senior Services. This is District 3 also.
Well, where are you at, Craig?
This was postponed once also. Mm-hmm.
We had heard from other people. Did they address all the concerns of the citizens in the area?
Seem to have. So I have not heard any more.
So at this point, things seem to be okay for this one.
Yep.
Do we all understand the variances that they're asking for?
If it's more than one, I might have trouble understanding.
Well, there's just a 40-foot exterior setback because of the overhangs where they people go in and out within the setback. And then the other one, from what I understand, is because with an INO or an O&I zoning, then the building has certain...
Yeah, it establishes a maximum size for the...
Because there's different establishments within the building or something? Is that...
Yeah, the focus is on... thousand square feet, the maximum gross square footage per business establishment. So you could
there's
have,
only one
could
business
have a,
establishment.
You could have a large building if it was split up into
right.
tenants.
Right.
9,000
square feet. I think I understand that there may be that the developer is going to pay to widen the road a little bit. And that may help a little with a little traffic there.
Right.
So I guess it could be sort of fair.
Are they they, are they building the left turn lane there? That doesn't exist right now. Or I guess they're proposing it. I mean, it's state right away, so it's gonna be what they're doing.
Bill will be at next week's meeting to be able to answer that.
That's an engineering condition the staff has asked for. Left turn lanes on Post Road for both the proposed entrance located opposite Dressage Way. And Dressage Way, both places.
We will check with engineering, they again put their comments directly into our system. I'll give them a change.
Because there's two entrances to Dressage.
Yeah, one of those.
Anybody else have any comments on this one? No? Next is EA 3653 Howard Road Partners LLC.
This is, of course, the second public hearing on this specific proposal. We had an applicant to change, and therefore we have to rehold the public
hearing. I have been working on some conditions on this. I put several conditions on it last time, and I made a mathematical mistake, so this does give me a chance to fix my mathematical error that I made in my conditions. So.
Other than that, are you planning the same conditions as in that?
Yeah, the wording is a little bit different, but it's pretty much the same. I may trade one of the conditions for quality, possibly. We'll have to see. But they're still being worked on and finalized. Has anybody else heard anything? This is the beaver property, you know, where all the beavers will be
relocated. The one condition, I would have a suggestion about one thing. One of the conditions started off saying all beavers will be removed.
Yeah, I changed it. I reworded this.
So one of those inspection challenges?
Yes, I reworded it about, I reworded it so that it follows state and local.
How about the kingfishers?
Yeah, and I will make sure that you all get it ahead of time.
Thank you.
Because I think that's really important. And I also would like for it to be shown on the screen instead of having to read all of them. So I need to make sure that you all are, there's a cutoff point for you all to get these so that that can be accomplished.
It is also, if possible, if you ever had to use an electronic format to get them electronically and just greatly assist with the meeting minutes rather than having to retype them.
Do they have to be submitted to you from the applicant?
No, I just verify whatever is said. As you know, I hunt every one of you if you have spoken conditions that don't have after the meetings.
Stalk us is what you
say. I stalk you, that's true. I have to.
It's kind of like the folders for this meeting. Mm-hmm. Has anybody else heard anything from anyone about this? Because I've not heard from anyone since the public hearing that we had on this before, when the public did speak.
Well, I actually hear from someone in a neighborhood, a surrounding neighborhood, that said that they were pleased with how it was.
Must have been Hampton's Grant. That's the closest neighborhood. Yeah.
It was right after that, the next day.
Okay. Well, that's good to know. Okay. The ZA 3655, Gary Hodges. Oh, Commissioner Nolan, you're up again. 9.23 acres. No variances in RES 3.
Okay.
They're getting smarter.
Staff is supportive. I do have a question about this. This is the one where one of the engineering conditions is owner-developer shall, as part of site development, dedicate 3 acres adjacent to Kelly Mill Road to Forsyth County for a trailhead parking facility for phase 4 of the Big Creek Greenway.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. That's a little onerous, isn't it?
It's a third of the property.
Well, yeah.
I'm glad you brought that up.
Three acres out of 9.
Whose idea was that?
Engineering condition.
It was this for parking.
Yes.
So you're
adjacent to Kelly Mill Road to Forsyth County for a trailhead parking facility for phase 4 of the Big Creek Greenway.
Do we have where that 3 acre truck is? Maybe.
It's in front, I think.
Yeah,
maybe a floodplain.
No, there's
no.
It's not.
No. That's, it's right here. Is this the property? No, that's the right in front. Maybe we ought to discuss that part. Is that the right thing to do?
I mean, we could ask the applicant if the applicant was wanting that or noted that they were okay with that,
so.
That's one thing, but otherwise.
I don't think the applicant wants that.
I can't imagine that the applicant would want to do that, but.
I have been told the applicant doesn't want to do it.
Yeah. Exactly.
I just make that
so.
Clear. I mean,
okay.
The applicant does not want that, and I don't blame him.
Sure.
So,
I'll mention it to Bill. Mention it to Bill.
Yeah, but he's not getting a whole lot of support for that.
I don't want to blindside him, you know, into him not knowing.
I imagine just in drafting that, he'd probably anticipate he would get some questions.
You think?
Okay. We'll mention it and make sure he's ready.
Glad you brought that up.
Yeah.
There's a reason there's a
deal. Does anybody have any other comments or concerns about that one? ZA 3655, Gary Hodges. Other than the trailhead donation, parking. No. Nope. Craig, have you heard from anybody at all about it? ZA 3656, Edge City Properties, Incorporated.
Have you got some conditions for that? I understand you have a list.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they gave me.
Have you got a copy of it?
No, I don't have a copy of it.
May I get a copy of it?
Of course.
I haven't seen those.
I'm sorry. They had said that they were going to be contacting everyone.
Oh, maybe on this list. I got a list of conditions.
I didn't say,
I don't know if I did, I misspoke, but no, what I said is I haven't seen your list.
Why are they giving us different lists?
I was just saying, yours may, there's so many on this one, they're surely yours or might be on.
Well, when I met with the adjacent homeowners, I was given a zoning application issues that look like conditions.
That's all I have.
But this is the addition, I mean, this, these are the things that they're concerned about. This is what they're concerned about, sure.
There's only the dark, no wheel. Is it possible for you to copy these?
That's not what you had already?
No, I haven't seen it.
Sure, just remind us when the meeting breaks up and everyone's clearing the room.
Can I give that to you before?
Well, let me see them just a minute so we can talk about them. Did anyone else meet with the adjoining property owner?
Yep, I think everybody has.
Okay.
Did you?
Oh, yes.
We're gonna talk about them, let me go out there real quick. I apologize, I should have.
Copy that too, I wanna make sure they have.
It's my understanding, and, you know, I've met with several people and talked with several people. Of course, it's in the fifth district too, barely, but it is. And there is some consternation over some of it, but I've met with the developer, and my understanding is so South County is going to be hard pressed to find a better developer to develop this property. You know, so I think that he's going to strive for a nice quality product there, and that's pretty important. I know it's surrounded by A1, but then on the outside of that, you've got some R3 or four maybe. But sometimes you just sometimes the what is it? Let's say the
R3 is
better than the one you don't know.
R3 is like 6 units to an acre. I mean, it's not like Res 3.
Oh yeah, I know.
These are R3s.
I know that's but this is A1, which is what really surrounds it. Mm-hmm. But my understanding has been that that may not stay A1, regardless of what happens with this.
Well, I believe that the applicant,
that's my property.
The adjoining
what?
Applicant.
Which one is that?
Acres.
I believe that the adjoining applicant indicated that Res 3 would be amenable.
Would you like to speak for a minute?
Res 4.
Sure.
Okay.
But he's going to go for Res 3 anyway.
Okay.
That's the bottom line.
Okay.
Zone for that, isn't it? But to say that my property is going to go for that too, how can you even say that?
Well, I mean, I've been told that, but am I being...
I'm the owner.
Well, that's good. That's why I want you to speak. I'm all ears.
I just put out my concerns too. I don't know. I think they might have been incorporated in other ones. You should have a copy. Tom made a copy of it for you. Yeah, I've got the majority of property around it. I'm concerned with erosion.
Uh-huh.
I'm concerned with the buffers.
Uh-huh.
Okay. You saw the topography. It's at least uh-huh. on the plateau that it's about an 80-foot vertical drop
uh-huh.
on both sides. Actually, on all three sides.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Now that's I've got a creek to worry, a little creek to worry about. I've got my pond that's uh-huh. now been filled up with about 800 cubic yards of silt
uh-huh.
all construction.
Joey, at some point, I'm gonna want you to ask a specific question and not
okay.
to keep this fair.
I guess. Yeah.
It's not sorry a public about hearing.
That. I just wanted to be fair to you. I think you made
a
point.
I just my concerns. It.
Thank you. I didn't want to shut you out, especially.
Yeah, but I'm not objecting to arrest.
Yeah, yeah.
You will be attending the public hearing,
maybe
so that you can get up and speak correctly.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
That's the time when you need to do this.
But the point, one of the points I was trying to make is, I really think the developer's going to try to put in a nice product. I think there's probably going to be products over there. Anyways, sometimes you take your best shot, and folks around there, I think some of them are wanting larger lots. But I'm interested to see how people approach the res 4, just like you were talking about the res 3, you know, or see if res 3 might be in there. But there's some
well, I know that the adjoining property owners are amenable to res 3, not res 4, but to res 3.
Yeah.
I think the bigger issue is the sewer. Water and sewer conditions are the development. Of course, it's if it is rezoned to res 3, that too, it has to be connected to sewer. But one of their conditions is developer to connect a precise system by gravity sewer. And it would be the responsibility of the developer to acquire any necessary easements to connect to public sewer. And sewer access must be provided to all upstream properties, and sewer capacity is not guaranteed for this property. So I think those are the biggest issues, as I see, for the land use of this property.
Okay. Feel free to contact me this way. Do you have much you want to weigh in on this, or do you want to wait till I get turned down?
Turned down.
Like I normally get turned down. I'm kidding with that. But
well,
lots of times when I put out an ask for it, I never get acceptance.
I think a res 3 is reasonable. I'd like to see larger size lots.
Uh-huh.
I have, you know, specific things that are standard for me that I tend to advocate for.
But once again, I think quality construction. It's very important there too. I think the neighbors don't want any more like Riverbrook.
Well, there has been some damage to some property from the Riverbrook development, and I know that they don't want to see this happen again.
And it's my understanding this is a different type of development. Calm some of the neighbors' fears and stuff. You know, we're working hard to try to get the neighbors as happy as we possibly can.
I believe there were complaints about Riverbrook from the adjoining owners that I met with, that there was some erosion that was being caused, and I was curious if the county has gone out and looked at the maintenance of their stormwater management facility.
I can testify to that because I walked the property and saw it.
The damage.
Yes.
I mean, if it's
the
not
county's involvement, I can. That runs through our engineering department, so Vanessa will mention it to Bill Powell. He'll be prepared to speak on that Tuesday night.
That'd be good. I just thought if there's drainage complaints like that, it's good to go ahead and know what they are. Good. And meeting.
Yeah, the bottom line is the residents' concerns, they've got some valid concerns, are the surrounding property owners.
And I don't.
But at the same time, they've got a pretty good developer coming in from what I understand. So it might work itself out to where hopefully people are happy.
Well, what I was asking shouldn't have any bearing on this particular development, just because that's another property. I mean, that's Riverbrook. It's on the other side of it. But I just thought, you know, I know that there's concerns the development is going to cause it. There should be a pond that's working so that it doesn't cause up.
Well, you're likely to hear about it in the hearing.
Yeah. So. And part of the problem is the sewer connection, and still got a week to work on that.
Anybody else have any comments on this one? /3657 Ellen Hammond. I believe this is Commissioner Neal's district. Did everyone receive the communication from Kevin Talent?
Mm-hmm. I had the opportunity to just speak with the one person, I think, that contacted him with concern. And I think that's about a concern. It's in your district, but it's kind of like you and Matt, it's across the street. And so, you know, I have a concern there too. And Marcy Krager's concern that she sent to Kevin, and he said he's going to be working on some of these, so what he has to say. But I would like to see it be architecturally pleasant to look at, you know. And I hate to see, they've got two service stations there now, and I hate to see another one right there, you know. So maybe they can work something out where if it has to be a service station, maybe they can dress it up, and then maybe the other ones can follow, and it can be a nicer looking community rather than just a lot of gas stations.
I think that we all got calls from Ms. Krager, didn't we? I got
one. Did you? Oh, okay, good.
No, maybe didn't.
Well, it was the last year she called.
What
y'all agree pretty much with what her concerns were?
I understand what she's saying. I get it.
Yeah. I mean, you've got the Walgreens across the corner. That one looks pretty good. I think trying to be consistent with what would be a nice looking product.
Nothing wrong with that, you know. That's something I'm trying to put. You know, get a restaurant right through that, get a Starbucks or something that was mentioned. Was that mentioned to you? But anyway,
they say what they put there, though. That's not our.
No.
We can.
Land use. Anybody have anything else on that one?
Not like that. Very simple.
The next one is the item that we moved, which is rezoning affidavit statement, Commissioner Moses.